All right, so basically what we saw during our last lecture was the definition of the inertia shape integrals. A very important set of quantities which are typically used to calculate the mass matrix during recursive formulations, typically numerical formulations, for the evaluation of the dynamic solution of a multi-body problem. So let's just recap a little bit, like so. So what we saw basically was that the mass matrix of the body I within our system could be subdivided into a set of submatrices, which we are already familiar with, like so. The difference with respect to the previous cases is that in this case we have also the effect of deformability. And so we have additional submatrices that we didn't find so far. The ones which are here denoted with an F subscript, okay? In particular, what we saw was that we had a set of quantities which were defined so to define easily the submatrices. In particular, for example, this one, the submatrix here, which is associated purely to translation, is a constant matrix. Okay, so this was seen to be a constant quantity. So once you have it, it's done. Then we have this quantity here, mr theta, which we have already encountered in our formulation developed for rigid bodies. But in this case, we saw that it was much more complicated. In particular, we underline a nonlinear dependence in the rotational coordinates. So like so. And the linear dependence instead in the elastic coordinates. Okay, all of this basically underlines a coupling between rotational and deformation coordinates, because we have already the presence in this submatrix of both rotational coordinates and deformation. This is QFI. This is a nonlinear coupling. The rotational and deformation and of course this is something new. This is something which is completely due to the fact that we are dealing also with a deformation process right now. So you see that the deformation and the rotation couples and make the mass matrix of the body I very complex in its formulation, highly variable, highly nonlinear, with a coupling between the rotation and the deformation, which is something that is typically not accounted for, you know, in typical structural courses that you have dealt with so far, you know, in space structures or aerospace structures courses. You typically only see this last part, so the structural mass matrix, which is a constant one, as we will see, as we have already saw, in fact. But going in order, then we have this quantity which associates and relates again translation and deformation. And what we saw is that these are nonlinear. In the rotations, one particular thing to see is about this matrix here that we have already discussed is that we saw that in the rigid body case, it was sufficient that the origin of the local frame was placed in correspondence of the center of mass of the body to make this term vanish. This is not the case anymore for deformable bodies. Okay, we have to have both the hypothesis of non-deformability of the body and of origin of the local frame being placed in the center of mass to make this matrix vanish. Okay, otherwise, the mere condition according to which the local frame is associated to the center of mass of the body is not sufficient to make this thing vanish, okay, to make this contribution vanish. Because during the deformation, we have additional contributions which make this part non-null, okay? Then we have, we saw another component, another submatrix, which is the one associated to the rotation. And for this, what we highlighted was a nonlinear dependence in the rotation, as well as a nonlinear dependence in the deformation parameters. Okay. In particular, we saw that for this submatrices, it was necessary to introduce various quantities, which we call inertia shape integrals. In particular, they were the following ones. We had SR0, R0, KL, I. Then we had SR0, C, KL, I. And then we had S, C, C, KLI. So what are these inertia shape integrals? These inertia shape integrals are nothing different from coefficients. Okay. These are like the coefficient of the matrix expression of the mass matrix. So that they allow to be only estimated once. Okay, you estimate it once at the start of your process, and then every time that you have to re-update your mass matrix, because your body is moving, you know, there is a dynamic going on, you do not have to re-estimate all over the mass matrix from scratch, which would be computationally insane, okay? You only have to reinsert the values of the rotational and deformation coordinates within the expression of the mass matrix, and thanks to having already estimated these coefficients, which stay the same in time, you automatically have your new updated expression of the mass matrix. That's the powerful advantage that we derive from the definition of the inertia shape integrals. In the same way, we saw that from here, we had the definition of two additional inertia shape integrals. In particular, we had SR0 and SCI. Okay. Then we also had the term M theta F, and this brought basically into table a nonlinear dependence. Again, in the rotation, and a linear instead rotation with respect to the deformation coordinates. Here again, we had the need, in order to be able to define this submatrix, of two of the already defined Linear shape integrals, SR0 psi and S psi psi. Okay. Eventually, we have the last term, which is MFF. This is again the structural mass matrix. Which is the one you are typically familiar with, and this is constant. Okay, this is constant in time. That's why typically you have in the structural problems that you have encountered so far, you never have issues with a changing matrix. Here instead we have very, very important and complex nonlinearities due to the single dependence on rotation and on deformation parameters, but also on the combined effect of the two. So there are couplings between the two, okay, which add a layer of complexity to the formulation. So basically, if we sum up, we have eventually 23 inertia shape integrals, which are needed to be able to define the mass matrix. Okay. Again, they are needed so that you don't have to re-update, re-estimate from scratch the mass matrix, but every time that you have to re-update it in time, as we have seen, you only have to insert the new values of the rotation and deformation parameters within the expression of the mass matrix to have the updated value of the mass matrix itself. Okay, this is what is typically done in numerical codes. So also Adams that you will be introduced to next Thursday, when it performs a calculation, it starts basically estimating these inertia shape integrals, okay, for the system at hand, and then it updates the various quantities, in this case the mass matrix, only resorting to this technique and to the new values of the generalized parameters describing the motion of the system. There is one, general comment I would like to do, and it's the following. Since this coupling between rotation and deformation parameters is so important, and it, you know, it contributes in a non-trivial way to the overall complexity of the system, of the problem, there are a series of approaches which tries to minimize the coupling between rigid motion and deformation. Okay, so there is attempts to reduce the coupling between rigid motion and deformation. And among these, attempts, among these methods, there is one which is very popular, which is called mean axis condition. So this mean axis condition is a condition that is tried and is enforced so that the kinetic energy of the body viewed from the local frame of the body itself stay minimum, okay? So minimize the kinetic energy of the body, with respect to its own frame. Okay, so what I mean is that imagine that you are located on the body itself. Okay, you are located and you are attached to the local frame. So the attempt of this condition is to describe the motion of the body so that its kinetic energy described with respect to the local frame is minimized, and the output of this condition is the local frame itself. So I'm attempting to define a local frame in such a position, because we have seen that the local frame for deformable bodies can be defined in more than one way. Okay, there are several possibilities, so you have to choose. Okay, it's not anymore as in the rigid case. So in this mean axis condition, what you do is try to choose a definition of the local frame for the body so that the kinetic energy of the body expressed with respect to the local frame is minimized, okay, so that the body has less velocity as possible with respect to the frame. And this is again an attempt to uncouple as much as possible the coupling that in fact exists between rigid motion and deformation. So they try to enforce a condition so that the body, said in a nutshell, moves as little as possible with respect to the local frame, okay? So that there is little coupling, as little as possible, between the deformation process and the rigid motion, okay? So the output local frame, which enforces such condition. Okay, is this clear?
What do you mean by output, Professor?
The output, by output, I mean that the what you get from this, from the enforcement of this condition, is basically the position is a definition of a frame, okay, in terms of position of the origin of this local frame and orientation, and the way it actually adapts and follows, if you want, the body, okay.
So we follow a procedure which gives an output as a local frame, as opposed, yes, to choosing a local frame which minimizes the kinetic energy.
Exactly. You want to to determine a local frame and above all a relationship between the local frame and the body, so that the velocity of the body with respect to its local frame is as small as possible. Okay? So that basically the body doesn't move, or it moves as little as possible with respect to its local frame, okay, during the motion. Okay. So you try basically to get as close as possible to the old condition, which was valid for rigid bodies, okay, in which there was no motion with respect to the local frame.
Okay. Do we perform a mathematical procedure for which this is output, or we choose the local frame as the first step?
No. That's actually what I was saying. We perform a mathematical procedures, and the output of this procedure is the the position orientation of the body.
Okay, Professor. Thank you.
Okay. All right. All right, so this being said, I would like to unfold with you the equation of motion for a system of deformable bodies. Okay, so let's put everything together. All right, to do so, I would like first to resort again to the virtual work theorem, okay? That we have already seen so many times so far, okay? So we have the first contribution due to elastic forces, the virtual work of elastic forces, the virtual work of external forces, and then we have the inertial contribution, as we know. The only new thing is this, so the work of elastic forces, because now the body can deform. And so we have the following. This part was already introduced, if you remember, for those of you which were present, in our last two or three lectures ago, okay? Where KFF, if you remember, is the structural stiffness matrix. Okay. All right, so we would like to rewrite such an expression, so the work of elastic forces, introducing a new set of coordinates. So the coordinates QI defined as such. So all of them, we have the position, the orientation, and the deformation. Okay. Well, it's very easy to rewrite it. We can basically define a new matrix, like so. You see, it's no more QKFF, it's K. Okay. Where this K matrix is basically defined as such. Very trivially. Okay, if you basically consider this new matrix K, which is basically the null matrix apart from the last term KFF, when you go and estimate this quantity, you get exactly the same value that you get here. Okay, I guess this is quite apparent, no? So if this is the case, then we can again make use of this new matrix. This is not anymore the structural mass matrix, but this is the stiffness matrix. Okay, so this was the structural stiffness matrix. Well, this is the stiffness matrix, and that's it. It's the general part. And as you can see, basically, the only non-null component of the stiffness matrix is the one associated to deformation. But this is obvious, no? Because, of course, all the others component, the one associated to rotations and translation, well, when you do a rotation and a translation, you do not expect to, you know, to store any elastic energy, you know? When you translate a body or you rotate it rigidly, you do not accumulate any kind of elastic energy. You do only accumulate, you only store elastic energy when you deform it, just like a spring, okay? And that's why all of these components here are equal to the null matrix, but this term here, okay? Because it's the only one which eventually can be associated to an accumulation of elastic energy. Here we are talking about work, but you know that elastic energy is the opposite in sign of work. Right? So they are basically the same thing, but a sign. Then we also have the first component. Then we have the second component, that is the work of external forces, and this is just the same as what we have already seen. So it's the generalized external forces applied over the new set of coordinates, which encompass both rigid coordinates, r and theta, and deformation coordinates, qf. In fact, we can subdivide the vector, sorry, this is a vector, it's not a cost, there you go, it's not a matrix. We can subdivide this vector of generalized external forces as such. So we have the external forces associated to rotation, the external forces associated to, sorry, to translation, to rotation, and then those associated to deformation. Okay, so these are the external forces, because you know that they're generalized, huh? So these are in the sense that we have already defined, no? So these are not just the forces, these are resultant of the generalized forces, so defined with respect to a set of coordinates, generalized coordinates that we have identified to describe our system. Well, with all this in mind, and you know, reminding also, recollecting also the fact that we can express the inertial work through the kinetic energy, that we have already defined in the previous lecture. We can write down Lagrange equation of motion. So let's make use of this powerful tool that we have. And for simplicity, we basically already encompass the most general case, the one for non-holonomic constraints. Okay, so as we've already seen, you can write this equation as it follows. The derivative with respect to time, and then the derivative with respect to the partial velocities, sorry, the generalized velocities. transposed. This is also transposed. Plus the Jacobian CQ transposed applied over the vector of Lagrange multipliers for the body I. And this was equal, if you do it, to the stiffness matrix and the external forces. Okay, this is what you get. And this starts probably, at least to some of you, it should remind something that you already seen in other courses, above all this term here, is the elastic force, you see? But if we keep on deriving, so if we derive, what we get is given the for those of you who didn't remember, but Ti is basically 1 over 2 Qi dot transposed over Mi over Qi dot. So if we consider this expression here, and we derive, we get the following. This term plus C QI transposed over lambda I minus KI QI plus QE. And this term here is the quadratic velocity vector that we have already seen for the case of rigid bodies. Okay, and it encompasses for, again, gyroscopic and Coriolis forces. If we basically rewrite this equation, we finally get the following. Double dot plus K Q plus the contact forces these are equal to the external forces generalized plus the vector of quadratic velocity. For the number of bodies going from 1 to the number of total bodies. Okay. So you see, in addition to what we had seen before, we had this part here. And this is something that imagine that you have already seen in other courses. And in particular, if we have some simplifying hypothesis, sorry. So if we don't consider contact forces, and if we disregard the quadratic velocity vector, you get something very well known for you. Well, basically this becomes right. This is the typical system that you have already seen, no? For the case in which you basically disregard the Coriolis effect, gyroscopic effect, and you don't consider the effect of contact force, or you have no contact force at all. You have inertial forces, you have elastic forces, and you have external forces. This is really what you typically write like so, in the following way, in the, you know, 1D case. Right? So you see a lot of formulation, a lot of complexity, but when you do the right simplification, you get what you already know, as it should be. Okay. Of course, this must be, you know, associated to the well-known constraint vector, okay, and this basically constitutes a set of second order differential equations plus algebraic equations. In particular, the algebraic equations are the constraints equations, no? While the second order differential equations are, which are this one here, are the ones regulating, governing motion of the system. Okay. The last thing that I wanted to show you today is basically the matrix form. So in matrix form, you can write the following. You can basically subdivide equation into this contribution, R double dot I, theta double dot I, and QF double dot I. This is the inertial part. Then you have, as we were mentioning, the elastic part, where only, again, the part associated to deformation is non-null. And here you have all the variables. Then you have the contact forces. And this time apply to the Lagrange multipliers, and then you have again the external forces generalized associated to rotation, to translation, rotation, and deformation. Plus the same subdivision but for the quadratic velocity vector. This is just a way of rewriting the previous equation. Okay. Plus, of course, the constraint equation. So basically, next time, not actually next time, on Monday, we'll see an example on how to basically apply this concept to a specific case in order to exemplify a little bit the concept that we have developed so far. So this basically closed today's lecture, so I will stop here the recording.